thank you very much for coming. And thank you for the introduction. I mean, one of the high points of my career was when we managed to get Jim to come and join us. I mean, he transformed our service and our research activities here. Very important. Okay. What do I do? Does that do something? Oh, yeah. I was sitting, watching the television early in the morning, putting off starting again to prepare this lecture. It wasn't going very well. And this came on early in the morning. I turned on to CNN and flicked between CNN and Fox. I watch Fox sometimes. You know, if you really want a laugh or deep depression, Fox will do both for you. But it was an extraordinary day watching it. When it started, there was no question that what was being presented, certainly on CNN, was another mass shooting. I mean, there were indications or people saying that there might be 1 to 3 shooters. But this is always said when these mass shootings occur within an enclosed space, within a building. And it's understandable. The police have to think in terms of multiple risks. But 99 times out of 100, it's a single shooter. It wasn't on this occasion, but it almost always is. And much of the commentary on CNN was about the lone actor mass murderer. And they had a number of people coming on giving figures. The commonest figure given really comes from a website known as the Mass Shooting Tracker, which claimed at that moment there have been 355 lone actor mass shootings in America up to that date in this year. If you went to the FBI, they were quoting 15. USA Today was going for 22, and I like this website, Guns Are Cool. Yeah, you know, it has a slightly different slant on things, and it quotes 12. Actually, it's not a bad website for this. How in the world could these things be so disparate is really the first question. Let's look for a moment and see if we can get some of it. Part of it, of course, is definition. How do you define it? It's obviously going to make a difference. Why does the New York Times and the Washington Post go with 300-odd mass shootings for 2015? For the reasons I approve of. They really want to push for gun control, some element of gun control. They're trying to get through to ordinary Americans, mind you, no ordinary American reads the New York Times or the Washington Post. But I mean, they're trying to get through to more influential Americans that really this is outrageous. So that's where that figure comes. And you know, guns are cool, well, it's obvious where that comes from. So one of the problems is, of course, it could be just definition. Now, Park Dietz, very famous American forensic psychiatrist, I don't think Park and I could call ourselves friends, but we've known each other a very, very long time. I actually rather like him in a strange sort of way. You know, sometimes monsters are really quite nice. I mean, people actually find me quite attractive sometimes. You know, so you can see that monsters will do it. Park, a long while ago, defined mass killing as 5 or more victims, 3 of whom were fatally injured. He did it very sensibly. There is a big cutoff in the numbers when you get between 4 victims and 5 victims, between 2 deaths and 3 deaths. So he didn't pull it out of the air. He really wanted something which was very uncommon, and that is the cutoff point. And that's what he chose, I think very sensibly. I mean, it's been changed. FBI currently talks about 4 or more victims killed or seriously injured in one incident. So others people use wider. So part of the explanation for why we have these very wide estimates coming over on that morning was definitional, but it isn't just definitional. One of the problems is there are different kinds of mass murder. Victim specific, where the whole point about the shooting is to kill particular specific people. So you get family killings. This is by far the largest group of multiple murder, of mass shooting. Way, way ahead of everything else in frequency. If you look through the websites and the databases kept by things like the New York Times, this is what most of it is. It's family killings. And family killings where two, three, four people are killed, five, six people from a single family, have been recorded, well, goes back to Saturn, doesn't it? But I mean, it's been recorded for a very long while. It's part of history. The largest one recorded 36 family members in one continuous episode of killing from Oklahoma. Lust killings are not very common, revenge killings, and commercial professional killings. These are all killings where the victims are selected and killed, a number of them, for very specific reasons, and cult killings. But then we also have instrumental killings, killings which are done for some other purpose. The victim's deaths are a mean to an end, intimidatory, used in crime, obviously. Killings to advance criminal activities. Hero killings, very relevant to Australia. Typical hero killing is the fireman or someone like that who sets a fire so he can then reappear as the rescuer. And of course, this can sometimes end in a hell of a lot of people getting killed. So that's another one. All of these could be counted, and some of the things do. Then we have genuine massacres, which is the indiscriminate killings, where the victims are chosen by chance, situation, wherever they happen to be, or very peripheral affiliations. And these, I think, are the ones which have always interested me, and these are the ones which are conjured up when people talk about the lone actor mass shootings. This is, if you like, the core. Now you get civil massacres, military terrorists, and one of the most unsuccessful papers I ever wrote was the autogenic massacre. I was trying to find a term which would capture this notion of someone sitting at home, gradually, you know, getting more and more plans and finally going out to murder. So it's all about themselves generating the plan and the killing. I thought it was really good. It absolutely fell flat. I mean, the best term is lone actor. There's no question. So lone actor mass killings. Very interesting group. Very interesting for a number of reasons. This, fascinating. Mass killings in which someone kills a number of people, most of whom were chosen at random and were strangers, in a single extended episode, is a relatively new phenomenon in Western society. Very new phenomenon in Western society. Not in other societies, existed in Eastern societies. I mean, most famously in the Malaysia archipelago with Amok, but not just in Malaysia. Throughout China, throughout the Far East, this has been a phenomenon which goes back for hundreds of years. But the first time someone went out with a gun, started shooting people apparently at random, continued shooting them until they were overwhelmed or killed, is relatively recent. David Gray. Why am I interested in this? I think my first interest in this started in November 1990. I was professor in Otago and lived along Harbourside, which is a very long extended harbour in Dunedin, and was woken by gunfire. It's not that unusual to be woken by gunfire, but this was gunfire, all semi-automatic gunfire, and a lot of it, that is unusual. And it was David Gray who was killing people in a small settlement about 10 kilometres further along the harbour from where we lived. He killed 14 people. Injured another half dozen. Among those killed was the nurse in charge of psychiatric outpatients and her family, and a number of other people that I knew. I'd never met David Gray, although I knew people who knew him. He'd actually gone to the same school as my sons. He's only distinguished himself in that school by winning the prize for shooting on a regular occasions. He was shot dead. Terrible event. So, started to take an interest in this, began to look at the literature, and came up with a kind of a definition. It's a project for murder-suicide, that's what these people are about. It's carried out by an individual, occasionally with one or two other people. Serves their purposes of that individual. They plan their massacre in isolation. And the whole point of it is it's an attack on the whole society. It's a way of striking back at a society which has failed you, which has rejected you, which has harmed you. When did it start? Well, it all started with Ernst Wagner in 1913, his first episode we know of, in Mulhouse in Germany. Ernst Wagner was a school teacher and developed a delusional disorder and went to a town which he had spent part of his adolescence, no, youth really, as a young supply teacher, and started slaughtering people. He survived, or he didn't intend to. He'd planned it as a murder-suicide, but he survived. And we know a great deal about him, probably more than we do about most of these people. The next one known is a man called Norman List. Won't be famous here, but he carried out his massacre in Melbourne, in the Botanical Gardens. Began shooting. I mean, wasn't entirely at random. He shot and killed women, and shot and killed and injured women, and then killed himself. That was 1924. And then there's a few of them. I mean, between 1913 and 1966, in the English-speaking world, or at least in the English-speaking newspapers, there are about 10 to 12 of these events recorded. And then probably the most important in its development, Charles Whitman, the Texas University Tower mass killer. He was American, so that obviously made it much more important. But the other thing was, it was the time of television. And they made a docudrama out of it. They made a film out of it, which you can still watch. Quite fascinating, it's called The Tall Tower. He became an enormous figure. He became famous. Enormous number of articles written about him, as I say, this film. And from this time onwards, the number of these events begins to escalate. So we have, say 10 between these two. They then start increasing. So within 4 or 5 years, you're getting 10 a year. How many do we get a year now? We really don't know. But 30, maybe more, 40. Depends on how restrictive you are and how wide you want to put the net. But one thing is absolutely certain, these events are occurring more and more each year. They don't quite double each year, but it's not far off. The ones in red are ones from Australasia. And some of them will be familiar, Julian Knight, Frank Vitkovic, Martin Bryant, okay. One of the things about these people is that they're involved in a project for murder-suicide, and they die, almost always die, amongst their victims. They're either shot down and killed, or they kill themselves. So it's not true that we can find nothing about them, because they often leave manuscripts and manifestos and quite a lot of information about themselves, but they tend to be social isolates. There aren't many people who know very much about them. So that finding out why they did it and what they did, other than their own claims and accounts, very, very difficult. One of the few places where a significant number of these people survived is Australia and New Zealand. Why? Why did they live in Australia and New Zealand, where they died in the US, Europe, England? Well, US is straightforward. They just shot them, didn't they? I think it was partly, if you read this stuff carefully, Australians and New Zealanders run at them. These people start shooting and they run at them. The Monash shooter, one person died going for him, the other one brought him down. That's why he killed so few. The same with the Latrobe shooter. So these people, same actually with Knight. who was brought down by two policemen who went for him. So we had an odd situation in Australia and New Zealand where a number of these people existed who had not died. And I had the opportunity of spending a reasonable, well, a considerable amount of time with some of them, 10 people. And on the basis of these 10 case things, certain things came up. Some of them obvious, already knew, because almost all of the research in this area depends entirely on newspaper reports plus occasional government inquiries. If you use the government inquiries, they're actually very informative. The newspaper reports, well, mixed, and I'll come back to that. Okay, they're young, they're male, they lack intimate relationships. And they're almost all of them isolated and bullied as children, socially isolated as an adult, radically isolated in many of these people. Very few of them have a job in the regular workforce, though some of them, students who never finish, people who have odd sort of jobs, that sort. But nothing personal for those who are not finished. I mean, I was a student for many years myself. They have a lot of problems with ressentiment, with resentment. This very prominent, almost all of them have a long-standing involvement with guns and or military and survivalist interests. Of that 10, 5 of them subscribed to a magazine called The Survivalist. Ever heard of it? I hadn't heard of it before, but it fits in with their kind of thing. And their fascination with guns was long-standing, with two exceptions. In my 10, all of them had very long-standing involvement with guns and shooting, and almost all of them had collections of guns. I mean collections of guns. I mean, you know, not the odd one or two. They were all rigid with marked obsessional traits. Another thing used to annoy Mr. Knight more when I saw him, which I saw him very regularly. He was there. I mean, he liked seeing me, I think. God knows no one else spoke to him. But he couldn't stand my untidiness. He used to tidy me up. You know, I mean, I'd drop things, papers. He'd apologize. He knew it was a bit inappropriate, but he couldn't stop himself. Yeah, I mean, everything. He'd go into his cell, I mean, it's absolutely everything neat, tidy, clean. Absolutely typical of these people. And that is odd. I mean, those of us who spend our lives with people who commit offenses, those who spend our lives with those who are violent, we don't come across many rigid, obsessional people. It's not something that immediately fits with one's notion of a violent person. But all of this lot, virtually all of them, were rigid, obsessional people. I was very glad to discover that, really. I mean, not having an obsessional bone in my body, I felt there was a certain justice that... anyway, here we are. Of course, they were all self-absorbed. I don't use the word narcissistic because I don't use the word narcissistic with all the nasty baggage it contains. But many other people have described this characteristic as narcissistic. They all had indulged, often for years, in fantasies of mass killing. They'd all gone out intending to die among those they went to kill. And the other thing was mimesis. Even Mr. Bryant knew quite a lot about mass killers who'd gone before. I mean, Julian Knight saved me having a research assistant. I mean, he knew more about mass shootings than anyone I've ever come across. He gave me lots of useful references. But that was common. I mean, they imitate. Mr. Bryant's called his parrot Rambo. There we are. Almost all of them had seen the film Tall Tower. Pretty obscure film. In other words, they all had taken an interest in mass killings. I'll come to it later. There is another thing which is interesting. These killings, it's very difficult to study. We know in suicide, for example, if you publicise a suicide, particularly if a prominent person kills themselves, then you will get a little cluster of suicides in the next 10 days to 2 weeks. I mean, it's like a sort of, it will precipitate vulnerable people into suicide. Now, it's an argument that all it does is bring these suicides forward, But one thing is very clear is that there is a temporal relationship between a highly publicised suicide of a public figure and an increase in the suicide rate through the relevant cultures. This is why there's been an extraordinary effort to control and to manage the reporting of suicide, with some success. People had tried to look for this with the mass killers, and it wasn't apparent. And we did some work with Chris Cantor up in Queensland. And what Chris did, which was very clever, was to start looking at a different periodicity. Stop looking for a change over the next 2 weeks or 3 weeks. Look at it over 3 to 6 months. When you do that, you see the pattern. Because these people all said, not all of them, but a number of them, talked about a killing which had occurred 3 or 6 months before. If you look at them, they do cluster. But it's not like suicide, where people are on the edge of attempting or killing themselves, they're precipitated. These people are rigid, obsessional people. It just sets them on a path which takes 3 to 6 months to unfold. There is a relationship between the reporting of these things, and I'll come back to it later, and their occurrence. Okay. Apart from that, they're a rather boring lot. Okay. Case history. One of the things which is fascinating is that you get in our kinds of work opportunities to see people who have attempted or gone away along the route to things like a mass killing, but have for one reason or another stopped. Now, I'm not talking about people who threaten to do it. I'm talking about people who've actually gone out and started on a course which would have been expected to lead to mass slaughter. And I've seen a number of these, and these are probably the most informative of all, because when you talk to the Knights and the Bryants and the rest of them, obviously there's a whole lot of factors which are going to influence what they tell you. But those who didn't finish up in quite the same situation. Here's one. Male, 19 years old, rigid, distant father. Mother had a paranoid illness. He grew up in a family where they spoke one language at home. He spoke a different language, obviously spoke English outside. Never close to his older sister, never close really to anyone. Bullied at school. He was rather chubby. Big, chubby kid, very bright. Overweight, introverted, underachiever. Economic function, well, despite being bright, he failed in an apprenticeship, failed to go to university, could have gone, qualified, but he didn't go. Applies to the police, they wouldn't have him, too fat. I didn't know he could be too fat for the police. Anyway, apparently, applies to the army, they wouldn't have him either, too fat. Had casual employment, not much of that, and had been unemployed for about 18 months when these things happened. Lost contact with his only school friend who went to uni. Unsuccessful attempts at dating, very unsuccessful. Increasingly isolated at home. Finally, living in his room. Mum bringing up the food. I mean, just living isolated in his room for months before this occurred. I'm socially anxious, surprise, surprise, but ambitious. He had great hopes for himself. Rigid and obsessive. A lot of self-reference, people talking about him, people being nasty to him, people being unpleasant to him. Yeah, the sort of thing that most of us get in adolescence, and some, like myself, carry on for the rest of their lives, probably because that is actually what is happening. Increasingly resentful and angry. And then he became despondent, depressed, and finally suicidal. Militarism, he'd hunted with his father, really enjoyed that. It's the only thing that he and his dad ever did together. I went hunting with my boys once. It wasn't very successful. They shot things and I couldn't. I didn't really feel this was a sort of good... Anyway. Began collecting guns at 15. He had a lot of authoritarian right-wing views, subscribed to survivalist and gun magazines. This is very interesting. Almost all of these people that I've had contact with have got right-wing, extreme right-wing views. Now, you can connect that into their personalities, their psychopathology, but it's a very marked feature. Okay. Rambo, tall tower, a lot of fantasies for years based on ideas of revenge massacre. And then there was a widely reported massacre 3 months prior to his starting on this project. As I say, always a daydreamer. A lot of heroic fantasies, increasingly violent fantasies, and for many months, fantasies of dying in a blaze of glory. It's interesting, Ernst Wagner, the first of these, planned to die at the top of a chateau tower where he'd put lots of inflammable stuff. He was going to set himself alight on the tower and go up in it. He didn't succeed in the end. But this going out in a blaze of glory is part of it. And there you are. He considered and rejected a number of scenarios, decided on a plan, acquired equipment, ran through the plan in fantasy, walked through the scenario, went through a dress rehearsal. A dress rehearsal which involved shooting things in the middle of Melbourne. And then he set off to massacre and die. What went wrong? He shot and killed one person, shot and injured two others. What stopped him was seeing someone shot, die in front of him. I mean, that wasn't fantasy. Couldn't cope with that. And that stopped him. Interesting. Okay. Seeing him 10 years later, physically fit, no longer obese, stable mood. He wasn't the most sociable in the world, but he was not bad, he was doing well educationally, no longer suicidal, no longer resentful, a lot of guilt and regret. And, you know, he brought the family together, you know, like a bit of murder, bring people together. Okay. Oh, we won't worry too much about that. No, we missed that too, I think. What is this all about? Well, when something arrives de novo in a society, when something spreads in a society, something which wasn't there before, I mean, you've got to look at what is the cultural niche which is allowing this to grow. What is it creating this? What's creating it? Well, it's a script. It's about gaining infamy, being finally recognized as a significant being. It's an escape into death. It's about suicide. It's about inflicting widespread grief and hurt. Why do they want to do this? Because they're angry, they're humiliated, they feel they've been victimized, persecuted, ignored. And it's about gaining a heroic, mythic status, really among those like themselves, a sort of virtual community. It's a very special form of personal vindication. Okay. Yeah, what has it got to do with these two people? These extraordinary couple who carried out this massacre. Well, it's another world, isn't it? Or is it? Brighton bombings, 9/11, doesn't seem like the same world. Terrorist organisations, okay. Now, anti-imperialist, left-wing, depends on your stars, you see. I don't think there can be anyone in this audience, if they know much about these various terrorist organisations, who wouldn't sympathise with the aims of at least one of them. I sympathise with the aims of quite several. I mean, you know, some of you may not know, the Irgun, it was the organisation, terrorist organisation, which was struggling to really set up the State of Israel and to make it increasingly difficult for those with the mandate, which is largely the British government, to continue the policies they were doing. Okay, so these are terrorist organisations. What's it about? Well, terrorism. It's the politics of spectacle. It's about gaining attention for potentially marginal viewpoints. It's about the politics of the act, which is very important in anarchist groups. Assert the possibility of effective and violent resistance. It's also about getting the society to do your job for you and be nasty to large numbers of its citizens and increase your capacity to recruit them. It's about exposing the vulnerability at the heart of complex modern power structures. And it's about speaking to specific audiences at the price of outraging and alienating other possible audiences. Very often people say, why do they do it? What in the world are they going to gain by doing such a dreadful thing? You're not their audience when you say that. Their audience is somewhere else. Now, in traditional terrorist organisations, they were trying to speak to a subgroup within their own culture, within their own society. Increasingly, of course, we're seeing terrorist acts, certainly within the Western world, who don't want to speak to anyone within the cultural society of which they're a part. They're seeking something else. The road to action. Well, you join an openly revolutionary group. The membership's public. It's political wing. It's a legitimate part, usually, of the political world of the culture you live in. You move from that to become involved with the militant wing, which is semi-clandestine, not entirely. There's limited communications between that militant wing and the wider public political wing. And then certain people choose to move to active service cells, which have very restricted communications, which are only out. Then you scope your target, you issue warnings or not, as the case may be, you commit the act, and then you issue your claims and your manifesto. Very straightforward. It's a social trajectory. It's done with other people. It involves identifying with groups. It involves being part of a collective struggle. It involves being part of a group's resistance to the powers that they regard as oppressive. But this is not something which involves social isolates. Well, some of them a bit odd, but by and large. I mean, my involvement with terrorists, people who've carried out terrorist actions, and people who've become part of terrorist groups, very few of them mentally disordered. Most of them highly committed, socialized people. May not agree with them, but I struggle to avoid the word decent, really. I mean, yeah, there's a few exceptions. Okay. Then we have something else which is really eccentric to what has been, if you like, mainstream terrorism over generations. This is your lone actor terrorists. They've long formed part of the picture of terrorist acts in Western societies and other societies. They're much more common among assassins and would-be assassins than they are among those who commit the kind of public outrage which involves shooting or bombing or killing a number of people. This group tend to be radicalized by books, by the internet, by personal experience, and sometimes by psychotic conviction. But it all occurs really within their own closed world. Relatively closed world. Everyone's got very excited about the internet. Actually not, I mean, I think the internet is a very interesting medium. Whether it's increased the number of these people in any way is a very different question. Some of the experts say no, some of the experts say yes. Okay. Ooh, a blank. That's good. How did that happen? Oh yes, look. A slightly move to the side. One of the fun things, job like mine does have some perks. I think one of the main fun thing, not many years ago, I suppose, around about 2000, 2001, together with a friend of mine from England, David James, and Michelle Pathé, who's now in Queensland. We went for a contract with the British Home Office to do research on royal stalkers. Okay, that was fun. Our remit was very straightforward. They wanted research so they could protect the royal family more cheaply. Bloody expensive. They wanted a cheaper method. Then involved some colleagues from America, and we set up a research group, money no expense, research assistance, etc. Ethical consent. Oh, I love the ethics. You know, normally it takes about as long to get ethical consent as it does to get a grant, which takes a very long time. I mean, many of the projects, by the time you get the ethical consent, the would-be researcher has either gone off and retired or otherwise. But you know, we used to get the ethical consent for this on return of post. Oh, it was wonderful. Got an extraordinary database. Anyway, it turned out to be very different from what we'd expected. We found that those who stalked and harassed the royal family, a very high proportion of them were mad. Let's not put too fine a point on it, they were mad. About 70% of them had histories of contact with public mental health services and treatment for psychotic conditions. 70% of those who were really causing problems, you know, making threats, repeat things, trying to break in, trying to dum-dum-dum. So the next thing we thought, well, that's very high. Presumably it's going to be lower among those who actually try and assassinate people, public figures. Now, we don't, you know, assassinating British royalty has gone out of fashion. There were six attempts on Queen Victoria that we know of, but since then it's really rather dropped off. So we had to do a study looking at all public figures, major public figures, heads of state, other members, other royal families in Europe to get a large enough sample. And actually we found that if anything, the number of those with serious mental illness among the attempted assassins and successful assassins in some cases was higher. Very high rate of mental illness. Very interesting forms of mental illness. Often delusional, but often well-organized delusions. A good number of them had what you could call a delusional disorder or a very well-organized paranoid schizophrenia. So that was curious. We didn't expect that. It allowed the development of a joint mental health police unit in Britain, which managed threats, intrusions, and various kinds of aggressive activity towards first the royal family and subsequently members of parliament, which calls itself FTAC, Fixated Threat Assessment, something or other. It's been now copied throughout Western Europe. Very interesting. Okay. So that was a slight sort of another area of interest. How does this all fit in? Oh, look at them. We got so much. God, we love publish a lot of papers. Oh, it was really good. Well, let's go back to our lone act of terrorists for a moment. There's a number of good studies. Well, there's a number of studies. This, I think, is probably the one I like the best. It's by Paul Gill. Works in University College in London. And this is, he's looked at, he's got 119 lone actor terrorists. Where does he gather them from? Well, this is a problem. Some of them are from people who've been arrested, people who've, there are reasonable details, but you run up against the same problem with this lot as we ran up with the mass killers, that most of them die. You can't get to them. The other thing is they use a lot of databases developed by newspapers, which is problematic. So it's not an ideal database. I think he's probably a little bit more scrupulous than most. And if you look at them, okay, you've got this group, Al-Qaeda, ISIS inspired, about a third. You've got this group over here, who are anti-abortionists, various kinds of pursuing various kinds of strange agendas. And then you've got another third who are just generally inspired by various kinds of right-wing ideas. Interesting thing is, very few lone actor incidents involving left-wing or nationalist-inspired individuals. So different from your terrorists. Huh? Anti-imperialist, left-wing, or both. But your lone actors, no, they're different. They hark back to the picture I was painting for you of people like Bryant and Knight and the rest of them, of these social isolates preoccupied by right-wing views with notions of personal superiority, da-dum-da-dum-da-dum. And what he did, one of the things he did, was to compare lone actor terrorists and mass, what he calls mass casualty shooters, those with no political motive. Found very few differences. That's interesting. Here's another study. Again, a problem with the database. But, you know, and he compared ideological terrorist shooters with non-ideological, non-terrorist shooters. Found they have very similar profiles. The only meaningful difference may be that for ideological shooters, ideological extremism is intertwined with their personal frustrations and aversions to society. Except in the ones I examined, and if you look at the studies we have of the other group, they also had intertwined with their personal difficulties. A lot of notions connecting particularly right-wing ideologies. He says, the one thing I hate is lone wolves. Never use lone wolves. That's what they want to be called. That's what they want to be seen as. They want to be seen as evil. They want to be seen as massive predators. They want to be seen as wolves. Bugger, don't let them have it. Don't give them that satisfaction. Preferably, don't mention them at all, but you can't do that. Findings consistent with the idea that the lone wolves and deranged shooters are part of a larger phenomena of lone actor grievance-fueled violence. Makes sense to me. Okay, what about a possible model? This is more difficult. I mean, I have seen a number of terrorists. I have not seen any lone actor terrorists. And the data available on them, I did have an opportunity once and I turned it down. You know, sometimes one's own ideological commitments really get in the way. I wish I didn't take politics so seriously. I mean, when I was asked by a very nice man from MI5 if I wished to assist in the assessment, I mean, I said no. Why did I say no? They had a large number of people I could have interviewed. I would have got the same kind of ethical consent dropping all over me as I did with the royal thing. It was quite a nice meeting, actually. I'd never met anyone. Well, I had, actually, but... this was a little aside. Again, it does take you to very... David, James and I, we have this little competition. When we meet in strange places, we say, how do we finish up here? And it's always a very interesting question. And then occasionally we email each other and say, I'm so-and-so, how did I finish up here? Well, I think one of the most extraordinary how did I finish up here was early on a Friday morning when David and I arrived at the drawing room of Princess Diana. She was dead by this time, been and gone, but her apartment, or very extensive apartments at St. James's Palace were left pristine. Here we were in the drawing room to give a presentation. Giving a presentation, it was connected with royal and parliamentary security. So there's David and I, and the audience is arriving. Some of them are introduced, one of them I even knew, which was the Commissioner for Metropolitan Police. Most of them sort of said hello, but didn't say who they were, and then sat down. And then one chap comes in, and a big man, pleasant, wanders over, puts a great big paw out, and says, you must be the professor from Australia. So I said, yes, and I shook his large paw, and I said, who are you? He said, I'm Five from Five. I said, oh, right, okay. And he goes and takes a seat. So we had a minder called Susan. I've no idea what her right name was. She was a very senior person within the Home Office who integrated aspects of the protection services. So I went over to Susan. I said, who's that chap over there, the big one? Oh, she said, that's Five from Five. Isn't it wonderful? They actually do it. They go around calling each other by names. He came up to me afterwards and said, oh, I would like to have a little chat after this is all over. Would you mind? So I said, no, no. He said, you sure you can spare the time, son? And after we were having our little chat, this was when the possibility of getting access to all these terrorists came up. But before that, he said, I think we know each other well enough now. You can call me Michael. I'm sure whatever his name is, it wasn't Michael. They love it. They love it. I had a patient who was a spy. And she said what used to drive her mad was from people. She was in East Berlin, well into the East Berlin hierarchy. And she'd have to meet her contacts. And they do things like, meet me in this particular park. I'll be carrying a penguin. So that's fine. So you go, and you expect, you know, a penguin book. And she said, well, the bugger, there's the bloke from the embassy in West Berlin. He's got a stuffed penguin under his arm. I mean, they love it. Actually, I wish I'd become a spy. I could have got two salaries all my life. They did invite me, but again, one of those ideological moments. I said, no. Anyway, here we go. Where are we? Oh, yes. How do these people get... It's very similar, I think, the road that the lone actor massacres take. They're socially isolated and self-absorbed, almost all of them, as far as we can tell. They have a sense, intense sense of personal grievance. To some extent, it's often justified. An experience of the self as a powerless victim, very, very important. They acquire an identification with those seen as similarly victimized through reading the internet or TV. They adopt an ideology or theology. This is one of the things that's changed. I mean, good old respectable terrorists, they were fighting imperialism, they were fighting for socialism, they were fighting for communism, or they were just trying to kill the Brits. I mean, you know, all perfectly good, decent objectives. This bloody religion stuff. Anyway, it's all there now, theology, which links them to fellow victims and offers vicarious vindication through their struggle. Okay? The intention to act is precipitated. It's very clear what little evidence we've... Well, we have some evidence. By a mixture of social, emotional, economic, and mental health problems, which leave them despairing and suicidal. There's a difference between an intention to act and a commitment to act. The commitment to the action derives from the attractions of becoming a person of significance as hero, martyr, and agent of retribution. The action may be precipitated or carefully planned, dependent on their personality and the availability of weapons. Also central to it, again, is the commitment to die. It's about murder, suicide, just like the other group. Okay, well, fortunately. Some things are common to both. A lot of things are common. But one of them is the role of the media in legitimizing and triggering these events. And the other is the killer's desire to be recognized as of significance. The other thing is the importance of access to weapons and material capable of inflicting multiple casualties. Very, very important. Many fantasize, some plan, but only those who can obtain weapons act. Although this could be changing, as you've noticed now, people going out and trying to kill a number of people using the sort of things that are around any well-equipped household kitchen. Okay. There's one side of the media's influence. This is a group from Perth, from Curtin. Very interesting, in the Department of Journalism, and they're doing some studies in this area, and one of their first publications is out. They say mass killers aim to achieve a particular type of social status, one that inherently requires a specific type of news coverage of their crime, including wide circulation of their name, their face, and their motivation. They're talking about the mass shooters, not the lone actor terrorists. That's what they're talking about. This is also about the lone actor shooters. In media coverage of mass shootings, not only glorification, but also demonization have to be avoided, as well as simplification of the motive to prevent persons at risk identifying with the perpetrator. Terribly important. Right? Certainly the ones I talked to, there was that identification with a previous mass killer, which really moved the thing from fantasy, planning, to the beginning of action. To discourage mass shooting, more needs to be done to deprive the killer of an audience, Never publish a shooter's propaganda. Hide their names and faces. Minimise the specifics and gory details. The Norwegians did it so well, didn't they? Jesus! They let that lunatic stand up in court for day in, day out. How many people will die as a result of that extraordinary amount of publicity? A lot of people will die. The trouble is, the more we give space to these people, the more people will follow them. Difficult not to, I know. But just as in suicide, you can report the fact that a famous person killed themselves. It's how you do it. Do you give all of the things they want? Make them famous. Does it work if you don't talk about it? Christopher Lewis, 1984. I was professor of psychiatry in Dunedin. I saw a young man, you see this one, two young men had tried to rob a bank. It was totally incompetent. It was all rather sad, really. They came in with shotguns and masks over their, well, stocking masks over their head, and the lady behind the counter looked up at one of them and said, "Oh my goodness," she said, "when your dad hears about this, he's going to be ever so upset." His father was an orthopaedic surgeon in the Dunedin Public Hospital. And so they fled, of course. Anyway, I saw that one, but I didn't see this chap. He was the other one. Never knew what happened to him. Well, the Queen visited Dunedin in 1984, and all the heads of department were given that lovely invitation to meet the Queen. I'm a Republican, so I said, no thanks. So they all met the Queen, except me. I mean, actually, I was spending my time with the police trying to persuade them to let my research assistant, who'd recently arrived from England, go. He was standing outside Dunedin Public Hospital with a large sign saying, "Go home and stop following me." I mean, it's perfectly reasonable. Anyway, I know what happened. What happened that day was this man tried to assassinate the Queen. He shot at her. Do you know about that? It's actually available if you know how to get onto the internet. He tried and shot at the Queen in Dunedin. What happened to him? Well, he was certified at the local police station, I discovered later, many years later. How he was certified and by whom, I have not got an idea. I was head of psychiatry. I was clinical director. The only person who's supposed to have carried out a certification, it was me. I didn't do it. He disappeared that night and finished up in Lake Alice, which is a hideous maximum security hospital in the North Island of New Zealand, where he stayed for the next 15 years. That made him disappear. Wasn't reported. Why? Well, because the thing that is feared more than anything else is imitators. Is triggering more. You know, the message of Queen Victoria is it's not good to give these people publicity. You just get more of them. Poor old Victoria spent most of her time dodging bullets or watching men struggle to get the gun go off, which wouldn't go off. I mean, you know, and they got lots and lots of publicity. I mean, a long while ago it was decided, don't report it and you won't encourage it. Every so often they fail, of course. Anyone remember him? Aram. He got his way into one of the princeling's birthday parties. He's supposed to be dressed as Osama bin Laden, okay? So it got all on the newspaper's front page, got a lot of television coverage, etc. Over the next 2 weeks, there were 25 break-ins into royal palaces in men dressed as Osama bin Laden. 20 bloody five. Now, the only reason these men survived was down to the experience and common sense of the protective officers who were there. I mean, that they didn't get a bullet in the chest is a miracle. So you give publicity to it and you produce imitators. I mean, why would you want to imitate it? But they do. They do. Oh, what a good idea. Oh, yeah. Back in 1981, I was a consultant at the Maudsley Hospital. Did a bit of forensic. You got a call from a lawyer I worked with. This is not anywhere in the internet. This man had attempted to assassinate Maggie Thatcher. And just attempted to assassinate Maggie Thatcher. he had finished up in her office in the early morning, and when she came in by herself, he closed the door behind her and was there face to face with Thatcher. There was Thatcher, armed with her handbag and her glasses, and there was him, armed with a very large kitchen knife. And he'd come to kill her. Except, as he said to me, I looked at her, she was just a frightened old woman. I couldn't stab a frightened old woman. Fair enough. So, sadly, this lack of spine meant it was only 30 years later that she went to join her coven in the sky. Now, this wasn't reported. There was a trial. I gave evidence at the trial at the Old Bailey. Never reported. I mean, why? It's so important not to report it. Because by not reporting it, you don't risk the imitation, and you don't encourage people, and you don't, for heaven's sake, demonstrate how easy it is to get into the Prime Minister's office and confront her all by yourself with a bloody great knife. I don't know, when we were doing the research on the Queen, we came across a number of really quite serious episodes involving members of the royal family which have been kept out of the press, for good reasons. So one of the things is that you can have an effect if you don't publicise and don't give these people any oxygen. How am I doing for time? I've gone over, haven't I?
You're fine, sorry?
Am I fine? Am I fine?
Keep going.
Are you sure? Okay. Start walking out, that always gives me a clue. Okay. There's another side of media influence. Actually, I don't think that's all that interesting. We won't worry about that. The problem here, I'll come to the end of this bit. When we look at lone actor research, 90% of it is a study of newspaper cuttings. Very few of these people get interviewed because they're dead. The access to many of them is very difficult. It's David James who's trying to work on this. Very, very difficult. And, you know, the other trouble is you rely on media reports. There's a problem. Some media reports are very good. Some media reports are not quite so good. They saw so much detail, but obviously they're chosen to fit in with whatever the dominant narrative is. They're affected by the political... I mean, it was quite fascinating to move between Fox and CNN to see the different way the terrible events were being reported. Okay. In brief, I mean, this is the problem, that the reporting of these things is very much influenced by the political and social context. This is a rather nice one. This is from David James's recent talk. He points out that, you know, it wasn't so long ago, we had all these different kinds of multiple murder. And then we reorganized it. So now we have terrorism, you see. We shove them all in. I mean, same people doing the same things. We shove a few out, but now they're terrorist. What he proposes, we should go a little bit further and say lone actor grievance fueled violence, which I quite like. And then you get all these people back and you begin to realize that the lone actor terrorist is part of a rather wider phenomena. Okay. Let's look at some provisional conclusions. Lone actor terrorists share many features with those lone actors who commit or attempt to commit shooting massacres. Remarkable number of features. They are all usually social isolates. They share a belief in their own superiority whose nature goes unrecognized. They share a project to suicide. They often share extreme religious and or right-wing beliefs. Psychotic disorders are present in about 8 to 10% of lone actor terrorists and about 8 to 10% of the lone actor shooters. That's 10 times more frequent than the general community. And this, I'm talking about psychosis here, I'm not talking about depression and all the rest of it, frank psychosis. They seek through their acts of murder, suicide, fame, personal significance and revenge on a society were just humiliated and ignored them. Thank you.
We do have some time for questions if anyone has any questions or comments. We do have a couple of microphones.
Yeah, it's a very straightforward question. Do I think these mass killers should ever be released? I think the ones that we don't, the case I said who started on the project but hadn't completed it has been in the community now for a number of years and is functioning extremely well. I mean, I think there are good reasons why. And he didn't get any publicity, he's not known, etc. But it's one of the things that Julian Knight always used to raise. I mean, he thought it was unfair. He wasn't the worst one there. There were child murderers, etc., etc. Why wasn't he going to be released? It's very difficult to explain to him that most people who commit murder or other hideous crimes attack a victim or victims. These mass shooters don't attack victims, they attack the whole society. Yes, the people they kill are particular victims, but the whole intention behind it is to hurt, harm the society and to gain personal fame. Now, I don't know that societies can be sufficiently tolerant to let people like that back. I don't think they're a danger, I don't think they're going to do it again, but I think there is something about a project to hurt and harm the whole society of which you are a member, which perhaps places you in a position where that society has a not unreasonable interest in not releasing it.
Hello, thank you very much for a fascinating presentation. This relates to assassinations, and I'm asking you in your capacity as a forensic psychiatrist to comment on a particular case study. I remember hearing Alistair Cook mention in one of his letters from America.
You don't look old enough to remember him.
You were warned there are a few people in this room who are also over 23. He mentioned in a piece after the assassination of John F. Kennedy, that the Secret Service had noted that the highest number of threats to assassinate a president or a president was when he was president-elect, between the election and the inauguration, and that one case he mentioned in his talk was of a guy who went down to Palm Beach knowing that in December 1960 the Kennedys were going there, and waited in a car 200 yards or so from the house opposite the church where the Kennedys were due to go to worship. And he waited and he waited. And then John F. Kennedy didn't come out first, but Jackie did. And he lost his bottle, he lost his nerve, but they were on to him, the police caught him.
With all his ammunition, did I do that? And he said,
the reason I didn't do anything, and why, yes, I've got all this stuff here ready to assassinate, was that I looked at Jackie and I thought immediately, oh, she's such a beautiful lady. Wouldn't it be so sad if she were widowed? Do you find anything typical about that case, or is that outside the range of what you would regard as a typical case?
Well, it's not typical, that's obvious. The Americans until very recently, Secret Service in particular, downplayed the role of severe mental illness in threats to and attacks on presidents and other senior politicians. I think they're beginning to change their mind about that. It was all a matter of, to some extent, it was a matter of how they defined it and their attitude. They made it very clear, I remember in one of the early meetings we had them, to them that they would have no truck with excuses like mental illness. You know, it's not a matter of excuses, it's a matter of trying to prevent these tragedies happening. I mean, to give you an example of how blind they were to it, there was a man in Oklahoma who would threaten to kill the president. He threatened a number of other people as well. They also have the belief, well, they used to, that the more often you threaten, the less likely you are to do it. That's not true. Anyway, he threatened a number of times. So they sent down Secret Service, who found that this man had a psychiatric record, a bit worried about him. Couldn't commit him, of course, or get him treatment, because he wasn't having any treatment, but they set up an observation post in the street in which he was, so they could observe him. He then threatened a congressman. Congress security is covered by Parks and Gardens, Washington, believe it or not. Anyway, the special part of Parks and Gardens responsible for congressmen were very worried, and so they went down and they found he had a psychiatric history, and they knew they couldn't do anything about getting him treatment, or it didn't even occur to them, but they set up a watching post in the street. Whether they knew the Secret Service were there or not, I have no idea. He then threatened to kill the Israeli ambassador. So obviously that involved the FBI with advice from the CIA, who did the same thing. They put up an observation post and they were watching it. This man left one morning with a large suitcase, which is actually full of guns. They watched him. They watched him get on a train. They watched him go travel to Washington. They watched him come into the Washington, and then go up to the Senate. He shot two people, both of them attendants at the front of the on the security area. Didn't shoot anyone else. You know. And then he was overwhelmed. And it's very interesting because it's their ideology and their commitment to certain sorts of approaches led to this absurd situation, absolutely absurd situation. I mean, contrast that with what is now done in the UK if someone makes these threats. The first thing that's done is that their mental health records are checked. If they have a mental health record, which many of them do, then the local mental health services that are responsible for them are contacted. They're almost always out of contact with those services. Then they are visited by police and mental health people who are trained in this area, and they are reconnected to their mental health service. If they're a very high risk, they may be admitted compulsorily. If they're not, then they are just made sure that they're treated, and then then they're followed up that way. But it's interesting how the beliefs of security services and cultures and the way they approach things can have disastrous consequences for these individuals. I understand the desire not to stigmatize the mentally ill. And people get very angry with me when I keep on reminding people that for whatever reason, 10% of homicides in this state are committed by people with a psychotic illness. They are. The solution is not to be frightened of the mentally ill, it's to improve the services for the mentally ill, and to take the responsibility for doing something about the risks that they present. Because it is not a good move in life's monopoly to kill your mum, your next door neighbour, or shoot at the Prime Minister. I mean, I might approve occasionally of the desire to shoot at the Prime Minister, but it is... but you know, it really isn't a good... It destroys their lives. I mean, we're not as bad as the Americans, but we're not as good as we should be.
Just interested in why this is a male-dominated phenomenon, and what do you make of the recent husband and wife killings?
Yeah, it's very interesting. It is male, but then almost all violence is male-dominated. I mean, yeah, it's not more male-dominated than any other form of serious interpersonal violence. Actually, the rates of serious mental illness, apart from in the stalkers and would-be assassins, is much the same. As it is among serious violent offenders. Hey, men are a nastier subspecies, aren't they? Now, it is interesting that among the lone actor both terrorists and shooters, very, very few women. So what will, it'll be very interesting, but we will never find out what the dynamics in this couple were. It doesn't sound like it was the sort of folie à deux with a highly dominant, domineering male carrying along with him a subservient, less bright, less able female partner. She may even have been the main activator. We don't know. It's unusual. It's very, very unusual. And I think one of the reasons that it struck me was because it's so unusual, it raises all the questions about the usual situation. But terrorism, I think probably the proportion of women involved in violent terrorist acts is about the same as the proportion of women involved in serious violent crime. It's relatively low. Tells us something about the difference, doesn't it?
Hi, Paul. Thanks for your talk. Just a really quick question about one of your latest slides that had the David James model and the grievance-fueled violence and family killings set outside that. And I suppose my assumption is a lot of those killings are about grievances within the family, and given the focus at the moment on domestic violence and the prevalence of such, is there a explanation for that?
Yeah, I don't think actually family killings are connected with the same kind of grievances, nor with the same personality structures, nor with, I mean, there's a whole lot of issues that go into those. I mean, if you look at most of them, there are issues of possessiveness, jealousy, paternity anxieties, greed, fear. They're actually very different. I mean, when you look at your family, and I've seen, because it's a relatively common crime, I've seen a lot of people who've killed a number of their family. No, they don't. They're not like this at all.
Hi, Paul. You mentioned earlier that you don't like to use the term narcissism. I just wonder whether that's because you disagree with the diagnosis, or you disagree with the diagnosis in this context.
Ah. It's got all this psychoanalytic baggage. Who needs it?
It was almost eliminated from DSM. Well, if you'll join me in thanking Paul, we've got him a CD.
Thank you very much.
This has been a Swinburne production.